We are going to speak both of us, and we are going to go through quite a number of projects. I'm sure that some of them are old and we have really spoken of them a lot of time, but I think it's good when you can see them all together. So I hope that you enjoy it.
This is really a very visual presentation. I think the way we present our work is very much linked always to the many relationships that one establishes among the different projects, different images, but not only that, and this is part of the idea behind this very brief presentation now, also the relationships between the architecture we do and the memory of many other things, experiences, travels, lectures, works by other artists or other architects that continuously establish a series of connections among them. I think one way of speaking of our work is always linked to a sentence we like from the writer George Perec, this idea that every work is the mirror of another one. So, that makes sense when you look at the presentation we are giving now, that in the sense that we are not following a logical, chronological order, we are rather trying to transmit this idea that, like in a puzzle, like you see now in this sort of series of images, project after project, all of them are in a way saying that architecture is the result of multiple circumstances, I would say, that at the end are resembling one another, sort of like in a mirror game where everything mirrors another one and another one, etc. This is what we try more or less when you look at images like that. Some of them correspond to projects that we are going to see today. Many of them are built work, I would say. All of them, I think exactly all of them, are competitions in a way that makes also understandable the way we think in our work, in our daily work. Actually, our work is not so different from yours. We are constantly approaching new projects that come from a competition in which we have to rethink continuously things that we already were interested in and new ones that come. And eventually become one day a project that finally is built and follows a whole process, which is the one I would like to show you now. We would like also to tell you that this is not, of course, a matter of working in this sort of abibar work connection of visual elements, which it is also. But at the end, when one is working after a long time, because we are not anymore young students, we would like to, but we are not. We are trying to understand how our works relate to a series of architectural concepts. So when you see another sort of mosaic, we are talking here about questions that we want to, in a sort of transversal way, connect to the different projects you will see, which are quite different in program, in situation, in origin, but they relate, for example, in many cases, to this question. For example, the landscape. Architecture that is not only in relation to the landscape, but that sometimes originates its own idea and concept in the landscape content. Another one would be, and this is, of course, something that you always constantly think and work with, which is natural light. But natural light in architecture can be managed and interpreted in many different ways. And in a way, or one way or another, I would say that in most, not to say in all our projects, the way natural light comes into the architectural space determines the way this space is conceived. If we talk about materials, and it has been just mentioned before, the materials in architecture is not only a choice. It's not simply saying for us, what shall it be? Shall it be, in this case, concrete or stone or glass or whatever? For us, material is, in most of the cases, related to the architectural concept that originates the project. In other words, we are interested in this sort of expressive value of materials that in many cases, and I will try to explain it in different projects, is even developed with other people, for example, with artists with which we have been collaborating in different cases. One of the, I would say, questions that in these years more and more has been becoming a key approach to architecture for us is how contemporary architecture establishes a relationship with the architecture of the past, of the history. It is something that happened to us in many cases in which we had, and we are still working either in historical buildings or transforming or extending historical buildings, or simply acting in strong conditioned context. And this is something that has become, in a way, one of our, say, more personal approaches to this difficult question in countries like yours or ours in Europe, but not only in Europe. You will see some of the latest projects we are doing also in North Africa or in India, in which the history of the past informs and transforms, therefore, the way we understand modern architecture. Another key element, which is common to all the architects, all of them are, I would say, common to all the architects, but have become, in a way, our sort of leitmotifs, to use this German word, is geometry. You would say that geometry is always there. Architecture is always about geometry, but sometimes geometry has been understood as a limit to the freedom of the architect. And we really believe that geometry understood as combinatorial systems, in a way, defining just a few elements and combining them in different ways, has become a sort of mechanisms in which we have been working in the last times. And I would like to say, finally, last but not least, and this is also a consequence of the projects we have been developing in the last times, there is a question that was forgotten by modern architecture. If you think in modern architecture that opened so many doors, as we all know, it also closed some others, of course, like ornament, but also a key question, which is the roofs. The roofs in modern architecture became, as we all know, after Le Corbusier and Mies and the Bauhaus, almost universally the flat roof. And we all nevertheless know, and we know in the historical cities, that the skyline, the way the roofs, the cupolas, the vaults, the towers have been really characterizing really very much our cities and our culture. So in a way, step by step in different projects, the roofscapes have become not only an issue, but also the way we develop the section, and therefore the way the light is coming in, and therefore the architectural space. Well, this was a very brief introduction just to talk about ideas that, in a way, more or less in different levels are in most of our projects. And now what we are going to go is to go through a series of buildings in which we will try to explain you these ideas.
The first one, it's a building of which we have been speaking a lot of times, and that we are very proud of it. Any time that we speak about it, we still enjoy it. And I have to say that I'm very proud to say that this building got the Piranesi Prize, and I'm more proud to say that they are here now, the organizers of the prize are here listening to us, so I hope you still like it after the prize. Anyway, this is an archaeological landscape, and we are really now in the south of Spain, in the city of Córdoba, not in the Córdoba that we know now. We are in the year 940, when the Caliph Abderrahman III named himself the first Caliph of the Caliphate of Córdoba, and he decided to build the city of Medina Zahara in the outskirts of Córdoba in order to demonstrate his power. The city was built in a mountain, and it had three terraces. The upper terrace is the terrace for the Caliph, his family, and the administration of justice. The second terrace is the terrace for the parties and like social life. And the third one, which is not excavated yet, is the rest of the city. Here you see the area, the white area, it's the excavated area. And the other one, if you more or less see like there, like a rectangle, which are the walls of the city, is the area that is not excavated. This means that it's a very important archaeological site. So really the government of Andalusia decided to organize a competition in order to build a museum for the site of Medina Zahara. So we decided to enter the competition, and we had this dilemma, because when we went to see the site, we looked upwards towards the mountain, and we saw these beautiful buildings or this beautiful city. But when we looked to the other side, we saw the city of Córdoba that was growing a little bit, not uncontrollably, towards Medina Zahara. So we immediately decided that we did not want to do something like that. So then what we thought of is that we were going to act as archaeologists. And this is one of the first relations that we are going to establish with the city of Medina. You have heard now Enrique to say that we always in our architecture, we try to establish relations with the past or with the things that we already know. In this case, we decided to work as archaeologist, which in an archaeological ground. This means that we remembered another archaeological ground that we had seen, the city of Ebla, in which the archaeologist has traced an archaeological grid. So we did the same, and the archaeological grid was the one that was going to trace both the architecture, the architectural lines of the new building and also the gardens that were going to be around the building. Another one of the relations that we established immediately, of course, was when I'm saying that we were working as archaeologists, I'm trying to say that what we did was a buried building. And this means that we also established another relation to Islamic architecture, because we are doing an introverted architecture that is lighted by patios, the same way as Islamic architecture is. The building was situated really in the outskirts of the city of Medina. This is the walls that are not yet excavated of the city of Medina. And I have to say the city was built as a double rectangle, the same way that we also built our new building, which is a double rectangle. The inside of the building is organized around five different patios and a ramp. The principal patio, the middle one, divides the building in two areas. The more public area, where we have the museum and the public auditorium, or the more private area, where we have the spaces for the archaeologists and the areas where the pieces that are found in Medina Zahara are stored. Of course, coming down from the city of Medina, we find that the building only emerges about 50 centimeters from the ground. And we also see the rest of the gardens that, as I said before, were organized around the rest of the archaeological grid and are, the plants that we used were all plants from the place. I mean, are the same plants that were used in the old Medina. If we go and we go from the road towards the building, we have long white paths that lead us to the building and that are traced over that archaeological grid. We arrive to a place where the building is a little bit higher, about 2 meters out of the ground, and of course we go in through a ramp that ends up in a curtain steel door that opens us and introduces us to the building. In the inside of the building, our attitude towards material was to use the minimum we could, which we used white concrete and curtain steel for anything that was not structural. And we tried to work also with atmospheres. I mean, like in the courtyard, that we were trying to work always in relation, even though it's a buried building, we always try to work in relation to the landscape, so you always have the view of the landscape in the back. And we also try to use with our senses, like the smell from the granite trees that you can find there, or also the feeling of the water of humidity that comes out from the fountain that we have there. If we go in the inside of the building, the rest of the patios of the courtyards are thin, deep, and long. And we do this because we are trying to protect the... in Cordoba there is a very big, very hot sun, so we are trying to protect the inside of the building from the very hot sun of Cordoba. And this geometry, we also bring it to the inside of the building, because this being a varied building, it's a building where you, in all of the spaces, you have natural light. Some of them because they are directly open to a courtyard, and another ones because they have natural light from the top in skylights that run parallel to the main structure, and they are help us to organize the roof, the only facade of the building. When we go to the more public area, we have a museum that is developed in a one single space with a double height, joined by a ramp. And a very important area, which is at the end of the ramp, when you finish visiting the museum, you get to go to the highest point of the building, a small place, the highest one, the only one that comes out of the ground, and from where you can look to the city of Medina, the one that you are going to visit afterwards. After having visited all the museum and learning about what you are going to see after that. And this is one of the occasions that we are very happy because we were also working in the museographic design. The museological design was decided by the director of the museum and some other historical historical investigators, and they divided the museological project in five different themes. So what we did was each one of the themes was going to start with a curtain cube. We use curtain because it's the same materials that we are using in the rest of the building. And each one of these curtain cubes was going to introduce the theme and was going to hold the more important pieces of that specific theme that we were starting. The rest of the pieces were shown in big long tables, or even if we had important, more important pieces like the one in the back, which is a very special arch, then we could hang it from the walls, even like a piece like this, that it was a, it's a piece of one of the paths of the roads that went to Medina Zahara. And this is a photograph in which, well, I like a lot. Now here we are, you are students of architecture, and being an architect, you'll have this feeling sometimes when you are in the middle of construction and then you go there and you ask yourself, you look to there and you ask yourself if you really are building what you wanted to build or if you are continuing with the concept in which you started. That's why I like this photograph, because when we look at it, we see like this building is coming out of the ground as an archaeological excavation in direct relation to the city of Abderrahman in the top. Of course, this leads me to a series of relations between the city and the building. Some of them, I mean, maybe all of them, are personal. Of course, when we talk about our architecture, we have to. We always say that some of the decisions, of course, are personal, and they depend a lot of what we have seen before. Others are not so personal, and they relate to scale, and in this case, also to material. The city of Medina was built with one single material, the stone. And we also, in relation to that, we built our new museum with one single material, the white concrete. And of course, there's also an important relation regarding the color. The building was built in white, in stone, but it was covered by stucco, white and red, which are the same colors that we used with contemporary materials, the white concrete and the red for the curtain steel. Curtain steel that we used in big plates to organize the roof of the building, which is very important because, as I said before, it's the only facade of the building. As you see here, the roof, it's divided in different pieces with these lines that are the light that is coming in the building parallel to the principal structure. With this color and with the use of curtain, we do hope that when looking from the city of Medina down to the valley, the building really disappears in the ground around it. And from this building, that it's we are working in an archaeological landscape, I'm going to go to another one, another museum, now in the north of Spain, and now here we are working in an industrial landscape. This is the city of Lugo. Lugo is this city here, which has a very important center with a lot of visitors, and the mayor of the city decided to run a competition to create a new museum, a museum for the interactive history of Lugo. The museum was going to be held in the outskirts of the city. But of course, for us, it was very important to understand that we were going to build very near these very important walls, Roman walls of the center of the city. But we could not forget either that we are going to build in this old industrial area. So for us, it was important to take all of this in consideration. The Roman walls, but also not forgetting where we were building, in an old industrial area. What we really decided to do also was to include one more use in the program that they gave us. We were going to introduce a park, so we really built a museum park. It was a park that helped us to continue with the low density. The area that we are building has a low density in front and help us to make a transition to the bigger density of the city. What we really did was to create a museum, also a buried museum, that was going to be organized with a series of cylinders, void and full cylinders, around which both the spaces of the museum and the park were going to be organized. During the night, those cylinders were also lighted, and they reproduced like an light installation that was also the light that was given in the park. In section, you see here the building, and it's important to see this place here, which is a black box, because as I've said before, the museum is an interactive museum. So here we have like a black box, and the rest of the museum is for the physical pieces of the museum. The floor plan, as Medina, is organized around the courtyards and around this repetition of full and void cylinders. Also very important for us is to work with models and physical models. For us, it's important to work with hands, because we, in the models, we test a little bit the material that we are going to use. And not only that, we think that to work with models is very important, because they really give us an idea, a very good idea of the scale of the building. If there is something wrong with the scale of the model, be sure that we are going to have something wrong also with the scale of the building. Here is the built building, as you see, the relation between the different cylinders and the material. The material we finally decided to use was this déployé of Core 10, which allows us, all, depending on the way that the light is coming in, to see the inside structure of the cylinder, and thus remember and refer to the industrial area in which we are building. The way to go inside the building is through one of the main courtyards, and the courtyards also introduce the light inside, but not only that, because all the inside space is organized around these different patios, courtyards, and also the relation of transparency that is generated between them. In the black box of the center of the building, we enter in the same way that we enter through the building, and we have this special area, which is a hanging cylinder. So with this idea of introducing a box within a box and within a box, so inside this cylinder, we have this other one, which introduces the natural light. For us, as Enrique said in the beginning, it's very important both the natural and the artificial light. Artificial light, which we try to work in all of our buildings. Here, during the night, we have two different types of light. One more dense light, which is going to help us to go inside the building, and another one, which is the one that will be like this light installation that I was talking before, and that is going to want to be the one that lights all all the park, and also gives us this special situation in which the skin of the building nearly completely disappears, so we can see the structure inside, and this idea of relation to the place in which it was built, we hope that it comes out looking at them, at this. And now we are going to go to a different country, and we are going to go to Austria, in the city of Graz, in which we built this other museum, the Joanneum, the extension of the Joanneum Museum. We are here in the city of Graz now. And I have to say that this city is a very special city because all the center of Graz is protected by UNESCO. This means that it's very difficult to build there. And it's not that it's protected one single building, but the whole of the center of it. Well, in this city, there is an institution, the Joanneum Institution, which owns three different, well, a lot of buildings, but in this case, I'm going to speak about three different museums. The History Museum, the Natural History Museum, the Art Museum, this is 18th century, 19th century, and the library. The situation of these three buildings is the one that you are seeing now in the photograph. And as you see, in between them, we have this space here that is really a free space in the city, now not used for anything. The situation is like this because originally this museum was this, this building was supposed to be reproduced, doubled there, thing that never happened. So the Joanneum ran a competition in order to make a big extension of these three spaces and also to try to connect them and to restore the historical buildings. What we did here was the same as in the building before. We added also a new use to the program. So we decided to create a new plaza for the city and to use that space that was in the middle of the city. This plaza, through a series of conical intersections, was going to introduce the light below, and there we were going to make the extension of the three buildings. And also we are going to make the vestibule that can join them together. I guess that at this stage you are going to think that we don't know how to build upwards and we are always building downwards. But Enrique, I'm sure that we'll speak about buildings that are going up, not only down. So here maybe we understand it better in section, and as we see in the long section is these cones or conical intersections with the horizontal line that introduce the light to not to one of the basement, but also to two of the basement. In the upper area, we are having the new vestibule. In the lower area, we are having the extension of the library with more than 1 million books. Here in the section, you understand here the connection between the two buildings in which we act by restoration, and in the center, the area of the center in which we introduce these special, special areas that the museum needed. The floor plan, and as in the other two situations, was also organized around the voids, around the cones. And you see here these public spaces and the extension of the library. Of course, this is one of these situations in which it's very difficult to build like this. So we have to produce this very difficult situation in order at the end to create this image that is very simple and direct, like if something was, this had been always there, but through really a big effort of construction. One of the big efforts of construction, of course, was the cones. What we did with the cones was to imagine one infinite cone that was cut with different sections. So at the end, with different lines in this infinite cone. But at the end, we had, of course, the same relation. Here is like this idea that we are repeating through the buildings. We are using the same element, but always different. It's always the same and always different. Of course, the situation here is similar to the other buildings in the sense that we also enter through one of these cones, and we get to the vestibule that is going to connect now the three buildings together. In this situation here, for us, it was very important the connection between the new space and all the already existing spaces. We also managed to do it through the different cones, because as you see, we always either see the building directly or get a reflection of the building outside. All of the new spaces are organized around these cones, and of course, through the light and through the view, are in direct relations with the buildings of the outside. Sometimes also getting these unexpected situations in the sense that we see the building, but always in a different manner. In the outside, again, for us, always important the artificial light during the night, in which we try here to separate the light that we are giving to the new restored buildings and also the light that is coming from the outside. sorry, from the inside of the new space that we have created. And now I leave you with Enrique, and also in the city of Graz.
And also in Graz, but in the opposite side. As you said before, you have been the underground architecture, well, not underground, below ground. Underground is different, below ground architecture. But it is interesting for us to see how working in the same city, working almost in the same neighborhood, you will see that these buildings are very close one to the other. So in the historical context, we were approaching the project in quite different ways. Yeah, and actually not always because we wanted, it was also because the way this project started. This is what you see here, it's called Castan Döller. Castan Döller is a department store, a big department store, that is in the center of the city of Graz. If below, below you see the building that Fuensanta just showed, so that's the Joanneum. Now we were working, as you see over there, in the very center of the city. If you know Graz, and some of you probably know, there is a mountain called the Schlossberg. So from this high point of the city, you see below. And that's very important because the city of Graz, besides having these beautiful buildings from the Renaissance on, also from the Baroque and the 19th century, as you saw before, it has something very particular, which are the roofs. That's one of the moments when the roofs started to become, as I mentioned before, a quite important thing for us. You look at these paintings of the 19th century and you see these beautiful roofs of Graz from the Schlossberg. You see this image. This is a recent image before our project was done. And you see the situation, which still has this beautiful center with all this roof. Behind the river, you see some of the buildings that maybe you recognize because they are very well known. For example, the building that Peter Cook did years ago, and so on. But this, the area protected by UNESCO, is exactly the one that you see there. If you look more carefully, for example, here, you see that not all the buildings of the center of Graz have these beautiful roofs. For example, this department store called Castan Döller had all these buildings, some of them of the 17th century, some others of the early 19th century, 20th century. Which all these roofs that had been, like it happens so always, so many times transformed with air conditioning, with sheds, with storage spaces, etc., etc. So what they did is to organize a competition in order to make a new roof. This is always an interesting thing as architects that is happening to us in several cases when they ask you to do only a part of a building. In principle, one thinks that a part of a building can never be the most important thing. One thinks that when one wants to define an idea, it needs to be about the overall concept. But nevertheless, when one has to work only one piece, suddenly many questions become clearer, for example, for us working in Graz. Because if you see the old buildings, in the left side is this sort of 20th century Jugendstil building, the big one. On the right side, you see the 17th century building. You see all these many additions that were done. Our proposal, if you look at it there in the center, was how to deal with unity and how to deal with this system that allows you to work with a series of elements that can be repeated. This is a constant in our work. You saw it in the project in Lugo, in the project before in Graz as well, with the cone in different cuts. So here we decided, why not to develop a single element, which is this shed or this skylight. This skylight is repeated many times, several times, so that we can cover the different buildings of different moments in history. But more important than that, and you see that in the image, we can, instead of having one single form, one project that is already defined from the very beginning, we can have a system that can develop in different ways. So what we have is a series of skylights in which we started to work, as you can imagine, it happens to you at school as well, with many models, many variations, many different steps. Some of the models are done with a model maker in order to study the competition model. Some others are done in our office, and this is a very big model that is almost 2 meters long in order to understand variations of the projects. Some models were made of chocolate, for example. And this was not us. This, I have to say, when you achieve an interesting project, needless to say that you need a very good client. And in this case, the client was very smart. No? It is a private company. They wanted to extend their building. They wanted to make a new roof and extension and terraces and restaurants and so on. But they needed the approval, of course, not only of the city, but also of UNESCO. So the approval of UNESCO was very hard, because in principle they don't like to have new architecture in a historical center. So part of the UNESCO and ICOMOS specialist simply didn't like the project and said the project simply had to be a reconstruction of some roofs that were not there for many years and nobody knew exactly how they were, made of tiles. But some others were more able to understand that modern architecture can get into that idea. So the client decided to do how many? 2,000 chocolates or something? 2,000 so that chocolate. In Christmas, everybody that go into the Kaufhaus, so they got a chocolate and they, so we, and this is Fuensanta eating at because, and which is the first time we did it, but we have to do it more often, not to eat your building. We always talk about this, the different senses, the sight, the sound, but you never eat your own project. But besides that, and this proved to be very intelligent, not only the chocolate, also the system, because I don't know if you see it probably in the distance, not, but if you look to the section, there are several lines, yellow, red, blue, green, whatever. These are only some of the many variations we had to do in the many different meetings with the city, with the client, with UNESCO, with ICOMOS. This has to be higher, this has to be lower, this has to... But this, that can be a big problem for an architect. In this case, I have to say, was not, because the project was not based on a single form. It was based only a system that could allow variations. Besides, it was interesting for us that even if we are not the architects of the building below is a normal department store with some architects doing changings and so, but we were dealing not only with a skin, but also with a space that wanted to connect it to below. That's the reason when you look to them, as I told you, many different models we are working with, they always try to at least reflect that the roof is creating a special type of space below. For example, this house had this beautiful early 20th century spaces that in the 1960s were simply destroyed. Like it happened to many architecture in those years, so they simply destroyed this area. So even if we are working now with completely different forms and an extension of something that was before, we always wanted at least to recover this connection to the space below. The building started construction quickly, so it was built already partially. The thing is that for several reasons, this is a private company that is selling, so they stopped the project. Now it's already more than 2 years stopped. So what I mean is that some of the sheds are built, not completed, and eventually will be finished sometime, I hope, when they decide. Yeah. Another important thing for us was this idea of the public space. We were talking about, Fuensanta was saying, we were asked to do a museum in Lugo, but we gave them a park. We were asked to do an extension in Joanneum, but we gave them a new plaza. So here we were asked to do an extension of spaces they needed, but we gave them new plazas above the sky. It was interesting for us because today the we were in the Duomo in Milano in this visit with Matteo, and it was very interesting for us to go to the upper part of the Duomo, where suddenly it's like a plaza on top of the city. So this idea was in Graz for us some sort of, again, the leitmotif, this idea of bringing the public space of the little plazas and streets of the old city of Graz to the upper roofs. Again, thinking that the roof can become a new part of the buildings. The building is not finished. What you see there is the sheds partially built, the skylights, with a temporary, not a temporary, simply with a basic construction, aluminum. Those who understand German will read there, Bronzedach kommt. That means that the roof is going to be covered in bronze. This is how the project is thought. and eventually one day we are going to finish it and do it. In the meantime, it's a building which is in use, also interesting for us, and now with more an industrial view, and that eventually one day will become what we have thought from the very beginning, which is a match that you see here with a contemporary roof, completely of our time, with contemporary materials, and nevertheless, and this is part of the idea we always want to work with, in this sort of balance or dialogue or conversation or whatever we would like to talk between modern and existing. So the roof, Fuensanta was talking about the floor, the ground. Another project of the roof is this project we did in Germany. It was finished 3 or 4 years ago in a city called Halle, in a museum and a castle called the Moritzburg. The city of Halle is, as you see here in this, in an aerial view, an old city of Germany. It used to be, centuries ago, quite an important city. Nowadays, it's a smaller town, somehow depressed city that was in the east of Germany for many years before the wall and the unification of Germany. But the old part of the city was not that much destroyed in the war. You know that most of Germany was almost completely destroyed. But as you see here, the center of the city was fairly well kept. And you see the old castle called the Moritzburg over there in the upper left side of the image, which was an old, bishop castle, a big one, built in the end of the 15th century, that had, as you can imagine, during centuries, so many destructions, changes of use. In the 17th century, in what's called the year of the 30 years, the Swedish destroyed, in these religion wars of that times, destroyed most of the castle. As you see in some of the images of this romantic watercolors that you see there, so that two of the wings, the north wing and the west wing, were kept, were during 300 years, a ruin. Actually, in the city of Graz, of Halle, they call it the ruin. When you refer to the Moritz, when they say, "Ah, yeah, the ruin, the ruine." So, actually, you see the ruin as you can see in the images of some paintings in a very similar way to the ones we saw when we entered the competition. So, for us, the ruin was an important thing. How to deal with a contemporary extension for this museum, and nevertheless, not forgetting and losing the image that it has been a ruin. So the issue is not going back to the year 1500, who, by the way, nobody knows exactly how the building was. Now it's a museum, and it has been an empty ruin, as you see here, for 300 years. The other thing, I mentioned it before, is the roofs. When you look at the cities, you see the roofs, you understand that it's not only about the flat roof of the modern times. And you see the cities full of these pitch roofs of different dimensions. What you see there is a castle, but what you see here is an old church in the center of the city of Halle. And besides the church that is so vertical, so going up to the sky, as it happens in the Nordic countries very often. It was interesting for us also that it was a church that was so strongly and beautifully painted by an artist we admire very much, which is Feininger, the German expressionist artist, born in New York and died in New York, but one of the first professors of the Bauhaus. Maybe you remember that the poster of the Bauhaus, the first poster of the Bauhaus, the Cathedral of the Future, was a painting by Feininger. So Feininger was living in this castle, and he had his studio in the 1930s, and he was painting this beautiful series of paintings. So for us, all these elements were part of the approach we wanted to give to the project. So the ruin, the roofs, the expressionist painters that are going to be exhibited. Our answer came as a somehow straightforward decision. We only had to build a new roof, what you see there. And with this new roof, leaving the empty ruin, we could simply hang from above the new spaces that we needed for exhibition, like boxes. So as a consequence of this decision, if you look to the section, because this project can be understood much better in section than in plan, then you see that the long space of 90 meters long and 18 meters wide could be kept empty as we wanted, simply hanging from above all the new structure of the roof. Like we saw before with the Joanneum on all the difficult construction that we needed simply to leave a surface in the ground, here we actually needed a difficult construction, you can imagine. These are drawings of the roof we had to build, but we didn't want to show any of this. This is a sort of a big effort in order to, at the end, achieve a very simple thing, like a floating roof that almost is not touching the existing castle, that establishes this conversation between new and old, that at the end is this sort of personal interest that we as architects have, and this belongs to our own experience, memory, interest, but nevertheless express this idea of how contemporary architecture can interfere with the existing one, and nevertheless express very clearly that if they want, maybe in some decades, they simply will destroy it, our part, and the ruin will stay below, because the action that we do on the building is only in a few points in order to support this elements. So what you see here is made of aluminum, a very thick aluminum plate, so it's more a sculptural approach. It's like living in the roofs of the city. Of course, in this roof you cannot live. You cannot go out, because then it should need a lot of elements that we didn't want to have. So it was only one day with all our office and our friends that we went up in order to perceive the situation that that gives you a completely different scale of this city from above, you know, the city seen from the roofs. It is made with this very precise geometry that we thought it was very important in order to achieve something that maybe some of these images express. This is this opposition between the existing castle, massive, made of stone, heavy, that belongs to, anchors the building to the ground, and the will that many, in many cases, modern architecture expresses to float, to avoid gravity, to express that one thing is above and the other one is below. In the last year, finally, the tower was built, the tower that was missing. It was destroyed also centuries ago. This is a service tower, simply for the works of art that go above. That for us, again, continuously establish this sort of game, because it's a personal interpretation between the paintings of Feininger that are exhibited inside and the building itself. Or this idea that has the title of this lecture and our recent book, which is Memory and Invention. Inside, of course, you see more or less the same approach. Simply the ruin is there. The walls are simply restored. The hanging box doesn't touch anything. It's really hanging from above. The spaces in between become the protagonists, something that is between new and old, sometimes even with the old archaeological remains that are there, whereas some of the interiors become then the new exhibition spaces. And again, as Fuensanta showed before, this sort of personal continuous reference between what we do and what we pretended.
So now we are going back to Spain. And we are going again to the north of Spain, to the city of San Sebastian. I know that you have been in Spain now, you have been in the south, but maybe next time you can go to the north. The north is also a very nice area to go. Not so good weather, but the city really of San Sebastian is very beautiful. Anyway, this is a photograph that for us it's important, because it shows really that San Sebastian is a place that has not changed. The area in which the city started has not changed with the years. We have here We have here this area, which is the Mount Urgul, and this is the old city of San Sebastian. But if you we look to a historical picture, we see really that the city has not changed. The beginning of the city was in the same place, because this, which is the old, was the old city, was completely burned in a big fire in the year 1800, and it was redone in the same way later. Here you see also the Mount Urgul that is completely free, and here it's the old area of San Sebastian, which, as I say, was completely redone except for a few buildings. One of them is this one, which is the San Telmo Museum, and is one, as I say, one of the very unique buildings that that come from the old city that was not torn down by the fire. This is the situation after a restoration that it was in 1935. So here we enter the competition for the extension and the restoration of this building. The building was, that was the front facade. This is the back facade of the building. As you see, it's quite refurbished, I mean, in the sense that, for example, this area here, it's the old part of the building, this area here was added. So when we found the building was really a bit touched. We had to build an extension, a very difficult extension, because we had to extend the building in as many meters as the building already had. And we had to do it precisely in this area. This is the building here, this is the old city, and this is the mountain, the Mount Urgul I showed before. So we had to act in this very special area of the city, in which the natural element and the urban element get together. And specifically there was where we decided to act. We decided to act here, in between the mountain, the natural area, and in between the city. And like that, we were hoping to redefine the relation between the mountain, the building, and the city. So what we decided to do really was to build two walls, two new inhabited walls, that through the geometry were going to relate both to the already existing structures of the mountain and also to the existing building, creating void spaces where the building already had void spaces, like, for example, here in the courtyard in relation to this new courtyard of the inside. And of course, also in these two inhabited walls, we were going to integrate other urban elements, like the stairs that are the ones that lead us to the natural space, to the Mount Urgul. Of course, well, this is the floor plan that you can see it better. Here is the old the convent. Here is the courtyard, the church, and the chapels that are already, that they are all original buildings. So we decided to act here by restoring the building, and here is the new extension. The new extension and the old one touch in only three areas. The minimum points, because we wanted to make sure that the circulation of the building was going to work. Here you see also a very special characteristic here. You see that the courtyard is like tilted. And this is, we think, because the mountain is coming in, and it was very difficult to build because we had a lot of stone here. So as you have seen in the floor plan, for us it was very important really the facade, the new facade that was going to cover these two inhabited walls, because it was through the facade, or it is through the facade, that the relation between the old building and the contemporary one, the new one, is going to be established. So for this facade, we wanted this new facade to belong to the natural area. So we did. We took long walks through the Mount Urgul with Leopoldo Ferran and Agustina Otero, which are two artists from San Sebastian that were collaborating with us in the facade. And we saw this specific situation in which we found the rocks perforated with holes that were perforated by the sand and the wind. And through these holes, there were also some vegetation, some green coming out. So we decided to do this same situation for our facade. We took some perforated aluminium panels, and through these perforations, the green element was going to come and was going to cover the facade and make it belong more to the natural area than to the urban area and establish this new relation that we were looking for. Of course, what we did really was, again, do the same system. We were going to build the whole facade by the combination and repetition of the same element. We were working with five different panels, from the panel that is completely with no holes to a panel that is very perforated with up to 260 holes. From the different combination of all of them, we managed to build the whole facade with the picture or the diagram of the holes that we wanted to get. From the distance, when you see the facade, you have this idea that it's one single volume. But when you are getting near it, you start to appreciate the different layers of the facade, especially when the facade comes and it also is doing the entrance doors. And not only that, but it's introducing herself into the building, into the courtyard, and is conforming all the new spaces. The different layering that I was speaking about, maybe we can see it better in the night. In this situation, as in all of our other buildings, you see that we give very important to the artificial light. And we have this different layering, one for the natural light coming in the building, another one for the artificial light during the night, really the opposite, coming out the building, and the third one, which is this layer for the vegetation, for the plants that are going to cover or will cover in some day the facade. Again, the same as in Medina Zahara, I'm putting this photograph here in order to make you understand the very difficult situation in which we were building, because we were building really between the historical building and the mountain. So we had this very thin space to build, and of course, this geometry also is taken to the inside of the building. In the inside of the building, we are also building with white concrete these very long spaces that relate also to the geometry of the old building, like this exhibition area that relates to the church which we have in front, and also with these horizontal openings that always allow us to see the historical building in front of which we are building. But the relation not only gets through the horizontal elements, also through the vertical, because we built a section in which the upper elements are hung from the roof in order to be able to get the natural light sliding in through the roof to the ground, and also getting a special relation of the three different floors of the building, so we can get connected all of the exhibition areas. Also, we have, again, this space in which we have like a space within a space. And in this sense, we relate also to the street and to the outside of the city, of the building. So you see these narrow spaces that frame, in a way, the old building, which is in the back of the street. In the same way that we also do with the new building, in which also these two different walls frame one of the new elements of the new facade of the building. During the night, the building gives light to the new plaza, and this new plaza is newly conformed by the relation between the old facade, the new facade, and this lighting that is coming out of this old facade. And now, from this building that we can speak very especially about the facade and the relation with this facade to the mountain, we are going to go to another one that is really a hospital extension, but it's also a facade. Enrique was talking before about these situations in which we sometimes find ourselves in the sense that we have to act with one single architectural element. Here we are in Bristol, in Great Britain, and this blue building here, it's a hospital. As lots of the hospitals, of course, it has been very transformed. When we were called to enter a competition in which we were showed this facade, and this facade apparently had been in the newspapers as the most ugly or horrible or awful facade of Bristol. And not only of Bristol, it was said to be one of the most ugliest facades of Great Britain. Well, when we went there, we saw the facade and we said, well, it's not so ugly, really. It's a 60s building, and we thought it was not so bad. But really, the people perceived it as such. And it was all really a little bit because the situation of the building was, it had been very carelessly repaired. It has also been built with amianto. Amianto is a word? No.
Asbestos.
With asbestos. It has also been built with asbestos, so the way that the building was looking was really not very nice. Also, the building was had been harmed with different extensions, and at the end, the result was really not very nice. So this is a hospital, a trust, a foundation, and the trust organized a competition in which were invited not only architects, but also artists to provide a new facade for this building. We really didn't know if we wanted to go into this competition or not, because for us it was, how can we separate a facade from the building? But at the end, we really thought about the facade was also going to create space, and it was also going to be the one that was going to define a new relation with the city. So what we did was like this idea of putting a veil in front of the building. By veil, I mean like that we understood the facade also with different layers. What we did was we really put a veil, something like that, that we cut, like we are seeing in the photograph, and by folding it, we are going to adapt this new facade to the different volumes that the building already had, and we are going to create like a buffer zone between the street and the building, and thus we are going to create also a new public space. We see the building adapted to the facade, we see that we are incorporating to the building all these elements that were sticking out of the building and that were really making it look not nice. But also, with this way of thinking, we could also extend to the upper part of the building that was not really asked in this part of the competition, but that we hope that maybe someday it's also going to be built. So at the end, what we did was a new facade that was organized by layers. One of the layers were in front of the existing facade of the building, and another ones were incorporating the new elements and also creating a new inside space for a new public area in which the people that went to the hospital could rest, could go in, and could define this new space between the city and the building. The facade that we did was based on the old building that we saw, because even though we were the newspapers and maybe the city of Bristol thought that the building was very ugly, we did not. We thought that at least the building was quite correct and that we should continue also with at least the geometry that was given to us. So we decided to continue with the vertical rhythm of the existing facade. And that vertical rhythm was taken also to the ground, in which, as you see, we are here in the buffer zone, creating this new public area between the building and the new veil or the new facade that we are going, that we are starting to work with. Of course, it was important for us also that we are going to work in this facade. We continued with the vertical rhythm of the existing building always, except in the areas in which we, as in the lower area that you see there, that we had to respect also the new spaces that were created. In this case, amazingly, it's like a commercial center created in the middle of the hospital. But we incorporated it so that it looks like a single building. Important for us also was the image, again, that we are going to get during the night. So we incorporated this element of light in which we have different positions for the light so that sometimes we can even use it like a moving light during the night, because we don't want to give a very high lighting feeling, but by using this moving element, we managed to get a much bigger idea of the dimension of the light. We managed to get this feeling that we have much more light than really the one that we are giving to. And also the extension of the facade to the roof, which we hope and that we incorporate to the building, and with this same idea of the lighting.
Well, I will continue with some other projects that, as you see, though at the beginning we were working showing only these projects in which we work in the historical context, you see that the context is always there, even with quite different programs, no? Whether it's an hospital extension or, as you will see now, a temporary building, something that we built in the city of Madrid, where finally, because we have not built so much in our city, as you see, in this case we were working, or we won a competition for a sort of important area of this dense part of the center of Madrid. Actually, the competition was very ambitious because it asked to work also in the landscape treatment of the streets, of the plaza, changing the vehicle traffic, and working in an area that was defined by a market that was going to be demolished. It's a market of the late 1950s in very bad state that had to be transformed into in a new market plus a series of new programs. So the first part was working in this landscape intervention in which we started to work and in which we at the beginning defined this new treatment of these public areas in the center of Madrid, changing the cars and giving more spaces for the public, and working, as you see, with this area of the how do you say, the footprints, in which you have a footprint of the same form, as you see, this pentagonal form in different colors, in which they take you to different areas, some of them for the children, for the old people, for the green, etc. So this, in a way, is stating this idea that at the beginning, when I was talking about light, about landscape, about roofs, you see that these ideas are coming once again and again. And one of them is definitely this idea that geometry is very linked to this idea of combinatorial thinking, that you define only one single element, and by repeating it in different ways, you achieve the complexity that architecture actually always has. So we are working, and this is a project still in the process, in this complex of buildings in which we have what you see here in color. In we have an old school, which is on the left side, which is restored. We have this linear building, which is in blue as well, and is a library. It's a library which is quite interesting because it's a library that is like a bridge, because below the children need the space to play in the playground of the school. And then we have in green a sports hall, which is on top of the yellow one, which is the market. So as you see, a hybrid building, a series of complex buildings in which we are working now in one of these projects that is taking a long time, maybe also because of the crisis, the economical crisis, but the building is going on. This is a bridge building that you see here of the library with the people, with the children space below. The building was like that some months ago. This is the model of the market. Above the market you have a terrace, and above the terrace you have a sports hall. So the building is now almost finished partially. It needs more work to be done and finished. It's all treated with all this translucent skin, but today I'm not going to show that, maybe next year if we come back. But we're going to talk about what you see over there. If you see the building in construction, in the upper left side, you see a series of pentagonal forms. These pentagonal forms are a temporary market because the city said, okay, we are going to demolish the market. So the people that sell in the market, the merchants, need a temporary market for these 2 years. This is what they thought they needed. Now we are in 4 years, so you see that the temporary market was important, because temporary is a very strange word. But nowadays, still the building is in construction. So we thought something. Okay, it's temporary, but we are in the middle of a plaza that you see here. So the city hall said, okay, now you have to build they call it the tent. you say carpa in Spanish, tent. Tent, where you attend for all this market was a very big thing. So we proposed to do, why don't we define just a simple element, what you see here, the pentagonal form. We define a pentagon that can be translated, recycled, so that when you finish the works, you can take it to another place. And then we simply can do something that was very important for us, which is to break the scale. Because if you put a huge tent in the middle of the city for 4 years, as at the end is taken, it's not the same as if you break it. So what we decided to do is what you see here. Again, a very simple combinatorial thinking, like the skylights in Graz, or like the cones in Graz, or like the cylinders in Lugo. So we are, and maybe it's because we are very lazy. We define only one single thing, only one single architectural detail, and then we repeat it. But this is a very way of thinking that is all over our life. We know that everything that surrounds us is organized in repetitive structures. We all know that. So here we said, okay, let's define one pentagon for the merchants. Let's repeat it three times. Let's put one which is the same, a little bit bigger. Let's repeat it three times, and let's rotate it in different ways. Let's have the roof inclinated, so when you rotate it, things start to change, though the project is always the same and the detail is always the same. And then the intermediate space becomes the protagonist of the architectural space. And this is basically the architectural concept behind what we did. So the project, actually, this was built very quickly. It was built in 3 or 4 months, and then the buildings they have very simple details, a metal structure. They rotate in different ways, so they break the scale of this very dense area of the center of Madrid, like you have here in Milano, and we all have in all the cities in Europe. We use materials that we like very much, but we don't like so much as a definitive material, because, for example, polycarbonate is quite attractive, but the way it ages is not so clear, but for us it's fine for a building that will stay only some years, like here. So it's made of polycarbonate, so that has also the advantage of the translucent quality during the day, but also the translucent quality during the night. The spaces in between simply have a roof, as you see, simply for the rain or for the sun, depending on what time of the year you are, but there are exterior spaces. The color is simply in the doors, where you have the different entrance to the different areas of the interior space. And inside, we simply define a repetitive system of stalls for the merchants with a simple structure and with this translucent space. Of course, the color comes from the use, and this was important for us. We didn't need much color because the color is the people, the color is the fruit, and the meat and everything. What you see here is a very small, a very short video. So as you see, a building that was only meant to be temporary, and it's temporary in principle, becomes also something that stays in the city, transforms in a way a city, and becomes, and this is something that we pretended, also an installation in the center of the city for this use. So let's talk about this idea that I mentioned before. Actually, we were lazy, as we said, we defined only one single pentagon. Let's do how we did it when we had to do a quite much bigger building, the one we won some time ago, and now we are projecting, designing, which is in the city of Munich in Germany. As you see, when you look at the model, there are many conditions that talk about the same ideas. Even if we had to work in a quite different situation, we had to work not in the center of Munich, but in close area to the center, also a complex area. If you look to this picture, this image on the left side, you see the blocks of the German city of 7-story high with the big hof or patios. If you go to you see the upper right side, then you see this sort of garden city called Bauernhausen, a sort of more or less high income area of the city of Munich. Then you see the highway, and below the highway you see all this somehow disorganized series of buildings that are mainly the fair, the Messe, the fair, but also office buildings of different moments, many of them of the 1960s and 70s, in which some of them the city decided, and the client, it's a private client together with the city, decided to demolish in order to build a new complex, basically of office buildings plus one hotel. So how to deal with this situation in which this is a complex urban context, in which we had a series of buildings like the ones you see here, and we had to demolish them and organize a new space. Our answer, as you maybe start to imagine, was quite simple. We should only decide one plan, and this single plan, in this case, this sort of polygonal form, can be, again, rotated in different ways, placed in the right situation that we think. So apparently we are doing always the same building, which is not exactly true, as you will see. And then we incorporate this public space that is so important in all our buildings. In this case, we propose this sort of park that connects to the park, which is above. In other words, we are able to work with this contemporary combinatorial thinking. That is something that more and more defines our way of approaching architecture, in which we only have to define one series, simple series of elements, of details, of decisions that finally are able to organize a complex space. Because architecture is always about complexity, but we always try to get this complexity with simplicity. And this is something that comes once and again in many of these projects. As you see, there are five buildings, but when you look to the model, simply the different buildings have different heights, so they become very flexible, because actually I didn't say it, but there are three clients here. The city of Munich is one insurance company is the other one, and a private developer is the third one. So each one has different square meters, different ideas, different phases probably in construction. So that was the origin of the whole system that now, eventually, we are going to build, because we are starting now with the design of four of these towers, whereas the fifth one that belongs to the city will still wait. But for us, and even if I cannot show more, but because this was only a competition for a master plan, it can help to transmit this idea that even if you work for a master plan, or you work for a small building like a temporary museum, a temporary market, or a house, or a museum, the architectural strategies belong to the same idea that is behind. And in this case, in the city of Munich, simply by repeating something that is always the same, but always different. So how much more can we advance in this system? Is this system only a limitation that in which we play with two or three forms? Of course, it depends very much on the type of projects. Now we are working in a museum in the city of Marrakech in Morocco. Maybe some of you have been there. Some of you know maybe the beautiful center city. We had not the luck to work in the center of the old city, but rather in the a little bit of the outskirts, what you see here. You know, they are, the outskirts of Marrakech are also beautiful landscape with all these palm trees in this in the surroundings and also historical areas. In the place where we had to work, for us it was important to relate to the historical background and memory of the, not only of Marrakech itself, also I would say of the Moroccan architecture, the Islamic architecture in a wider sense. And therefore, some of the elements that for us were important. When you look to Marrakech, you see these roofs. Again, the roofs in this case, they are flat roofs. We are not in Germany, but we are in the south. But flat roofs with all these beautiful small patios. But if you see the landscape in which we had to work, we had all this palmeral, all these palm trees that are precisely organized with all this series of plants. If you go to the detail, and you go to the details that you also see in Spain and in many other places, you see the geometry again, this geometry of the Islamic world, which is so interesting and attractive for us. We learn about that with what Fuensanta showed in Medina al-Zahra, and a building in Cordoba. So all of them, in a way, were different scales, but related to the idea we wanted to work. Besides, of course, this question that we all know from the Arab world, in which a very narrow streets, the material, which is basically the ram earth or the brick in many cases, are simply used to protect from the heat. So all these decisions took us, led us to the way we are working, because what I have shown you here now in Munich in this project and another one is only a couple of images of what is new in the office now, because we are working in these issues now. So here we started, as I told you, like you do, or like my students, in my case in Berlin, in the case of Santi in Madrid, we asked them to do, which is to work very much with models. So we started like this, like playing with units that we wanted to work with that belong in a way to this scale of the city of Marrakech. But actually we had to work in a museum, and this is a museum for a private collection of contemporary African art. So this series of images, because we are still in the process of design, belong to the idea of working again with this, achieving a unity, which is this museum that you see, out of this sort of boxes that are also skylights. And these skylights create a sort of puzzle, again the same puzzle we showed you at the beginning of the lecture, in which step by step we can work by a concept that is very much linked to this tradition in this country, which is addition. Instead of working by a general idea that defines everything, you work by the single unity. And you can add and add and add eventually with no end in order to achieve finally what you need. In this case, the project is complex because it's a museum, but it's a private museum, so it's a private institution. It has also a big restaurant, a shop. It has also galleries, art galleries. It has an auditorium. So at the end, we decided to work with different units, and these units, the form of the triangle comes from the site. The site is triangular, but it helps us very much to deal with these different eventual phases. Actually, now we are going to work in three of these elements that are going to start now. This is the last news we have. And we hope to develop and advance these ideas that today I'm not showing in much more detail, except that to understand that they belong not only to these references we had, they belong also to the way we understand in a broader sense how the Islamic work, the Islamic architecture has worked in many different cases. Of course, we have in mind, being Spaniards, of course, places like Alhambra. No? You know, Alhambra organized always in these units that are added one to another, to another, to another, which is something that you can perceive here. But we are working now, we'll show you a couple of images also in India. And when you go to the other extreme of the Arabic world, not Arabic, I'm wrong, the Islamic world, then you see that in places like Fatehpur Sikri that you see here in this image, again, the system is the same. One piece, another, another, they are added, creating quite complex ensembles out of a simple unit. Or in Marrakech itself, in Palacio de Bahia and so on. So, in other words, addition as a system of working, addition as a combinatorial way of achieving this in a way complex spaces. These are images of the future museum that you are seeing here. of this sort of interconnection of different spaces. Again, you see working in models, but in models that refer even to our own projects. What you see here, some of them we have shown today, some of them not, are museum projects in which we have been working or we are working, and the one in Marrakech in which up to now we only have images of how we are imagining the space. Important for us, and we have mentioned that in the other projects, for example in San Sebastian, or we'll see in the last project in Cordoba, is the material. In this case, working in Marrakech, we wanted to refer to something that of course attracted us always very much, which is the ram earth, the ram earth in English, tapial of Spanish, in Spanish. I don't know, in terra? Terracotta. No, clay. Actually, that, what you see over there, what you find in so many places in North Africa, you see it in Marrakech, in places like this, in impressive palace of Badi, which is now a ruin, but is so incredibly strong and attractive. And what you find in the north part of Morocco, in the Atlas area, all these buildings made of ram earth. So that adobe, in Spanish, adobe, in Spain, I don't know, in adobe. Adobe, finally. Ah, terra cruda. So our proposal, of course, cannot be all made of terra cruda, because the problem is that we are building a building of a big scale. So we are pretending to work in concrete, in all the basic white concrete elements that define all this system that you saw, with the exterior walls that have these thermal qualities of the terra cruda, the adobe, or the ram earth. And I hope, again, that one day soon we can see this building going up as we expect, and express also the way we try to react to the different situations in different parts now of the world in which we are able to work. Very briefly again, before the last project, I'm going to show another building in which we are only starting to work, and I don't know if it's going to go ahead or not, so I cannot, we are not even allowed to talk very much about it, so simply to talk that we are working in India. We are in the city of Delhi, some of you might know, huge city, as you can imagine, of many million inhabitants. And not in the center, but in one of the oldest part of the city, there is this incredible place again. There is one of the most important archaeological sites of the city. It belongs to that's an old image, and now it's in a different situation. It has some of the most important Mughal, you know, the Mughals tombs and mausoleums in of the time. Of the 17th century, most of them 16th, 17th, 18th century, when they were the rulers of India. So again, I cannot explain many things. The only thing is that in this impressive area in which where you see each of these red elements is a drawing of one of these monuments near also a historical part called Nizamuddin and all neighborhood, the one on the left. Our proposal, the proposal we got is to propose a new visitor center for this part of the historical area. So again, here we are starting, because this is a project that is only starting, to work with this idea of the Mughal Islamic architecture, so different from the Spanish and from the one in Morocco or in Sicilia for you. So, I mean, there are really opposed extremes of the Islamic world. In this case, working with the cupolas, you see in many cases, but working for us very important with this system that we like to apply. They also were very lazy, I don't know. They define only one single element and they repeat it. No? In this case, strangely, compared to Spain, with the octagon. So the places, the octagonal combinations that you see here create eventually complex buildings. Or here you see another of the important elements for us, which are the baolis. The baolis are all these step wells under the earth. Again, this architecture below earth that we started work with. So we are not showing much more, only the concept of the project. What we pretend is to work with a big slab, and this big slab goes down and creates a series of spaces so that connect at the end the different areas almost below ground, but not disappearing, simply working with the idea, again, of the combinatorial geometrical patterns that we were thinking there, and also, in this case, with a material, which is a stone. What you see on the left side is the red stone they use in Delhi, or they use in Fatehpur Sikri. It's an impressive, beautiful stone that you can carve very easily. So we started to play, like we do in the office, doing games, playing, trying, so on, and eventually defining only one single roof. This single roof, not very different from the project in the sense of Medina Zahara, becomes the system in which we go slightly below Earth, and we define a big slab. But the big difference here, if we can advance with this project, I don't know if it will go, is that this huge slab of stone, of course, it will be done of different stones and concrete, but becomes eventually a new version of this scaled tradition in which they work in this part of India. Well, and this project, of course, that is only at the beginning in India, is a consequence of the last one we are showing today. And this last one is this Contemporary Art Center in Cordoba, a building we just finished the construction. The building is not yet in use, also partly because of this economical crisis that makes that everything goes slower. But the building is finished. We are in the center of the city. This is a project maybe some of you have seen already. But we are here in the nearby the old historical Mosque of Cordoba. The Mosque of Cordoba that you see over there in the left, part of the in the upper part of the image, is for us one of the most important buildings in Spain, if not the most, in the sense that it talks in a very contemporary way to us. It's done about a single element that is repeated, something that you understand that we like. And it's also dealing with a historical building that had interventions of the modern times. It was Muslim, but then the Christians built the cathedral in the center, et cetera, et cetera. So we had to work below in this yellow rectangle that you see, near a building that was won by Rem Koolhaas in another competition, which is the long building that you see there. This building is finally never going to be built, probably, because of the crisis and the changes and so on, but we had the chance to work in this new Contemporary Art Center in the place that you see. Contemporary Art Center for digital art, video art, so it's not for sculpture or painting. It's only for video, audiovisual elements. And for us, working near the Mosque of Cordoba, it had to, in a way, reflect this interest we have in this architecture. If you see the Mosque of Cordoba, you see a double arch that is repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated. And simply by repetition, they create this incredible beauty of space and light that you see. But you have been listening to us also talk about Islamic architecture. And Islamic architecture is about the same thing in ornament. When you see the ornaments, this is not from Cordoba, this is from Granada, but it could be from many other places. It looks complex, but if you spend a couple of minutes, you will see that it's very simple. A series of elements that are rotated, changed, etc., etc., to create all this space. So for us, the idea was, can we really, in a way, transform this ornamental space into an architectural constructive space? This was the idea that we have shown several times, so I don't know if you have seen it published or not. It's based on this simply play of this hexagonal form. You have a regular hexagon, you divide it in three hexagons, 150 meters, 90 meters, 60 meters. And then you take them and you start to play. It's like a game. You can rotate them, you can make symmetries, another symmetry. So everything is the same, but looks different. If you put them together, then you get a sequence. This sequence looks random, but it's not random. Like nothing is random in this Islamic architecture. Simply it's the sum of four regular hexagons with three small inside and a big one for the big spaces. That makes of it a non-hierarchical space, a space that can be used in different ways, a space that was conceived by us. When many people ask us, hey, what digital, even they invited us to a seminar saying, what digital program did you use to develop this project? We said, well, the digital was digital because it was made with the hands. The digital program is the one on the left. We started like that, and it's not a joke, of course. We started like that. Then later on, step by step, of course, the other models, the computer comes, and then everything, and then the computer becomes very important to define geometries that are not so easy to transform into built work. Yeah, when you see the section, the plan here, you see that it's a sequence. These yellow rooms or orange rooms are the exhibition rooms. So on one hand, you have the studios for the artists. In the center, you have all the exhibition rooms with the black box at the end. On the right side, you have a sort of interior street, like the souks, when you have a street, and then you can go to one room, to the other, or to the other, depending on what's going on in. If you look to the section expresses, again, the idea. And for us, the idea was somehow like inhabiting one of these, you know, they are called mukarnas or masharabias, or these detailed, small details that you see in Alhambra, you see in Morocco, and you see in many places that are purely ornamental. But our idea is, can we blow up that? Can we inhabit that? This is behind this idea that you see here, a sequence of spaces that you can go from one to the other. It is like an inverted pyramid, so that you have only one light in the center. And you see that this system that I mentioned, from the hands to the computer, to the models made by a model maker, to the construction and to the finishing at the end of the building, is simply a process that is guided by the same concept. Yeah? The building is in front of the river. In front of the river, there is a facade that can be seen from the other side of the river. That makes it important and different to the normal view that you have in a city. So in this case, again, like we have done in other projects, we invited some artists, in this case architects, artists specialists called Realities United from Berlin, to work together in this facade that is an artistic facade, a media, a dynamic facade, because it had to be in relation to the city and can be used by the artists working inside. So the building is now finished, as you see, without the exterior, without the interior installation. Things are like in the market in Barcelona, coming slowly, but eventually it will be finally done. The building is in front of the river, as you see there, near the old city. For us, it's important to establish also this relation of the new contemporary art center with the old city, and on the other side of the river, the mosque, this big building that you see on the upper part, that for us is always not a reference only for this project. It's a reference for our way of thinking, as I mentioned before. So this is an image of the building from the river, and this is the backside of the facade, in which there is a different scale with the studios for the artist. When you see the plan, the entrance and the exterior is only a consequence of the negative space of this system. So you enter like that, when you see here, and then the white exterior, because the whole element outside is a prefabricated white GRC, so glass reinforced concrete system. The inside wanted to be more like a factory. All our friends, artists, when we are talking about spaces like that, they said, why do you build a new building? Well, what we want is an old industrial building or an old factory. These are the places of contemporary art in many cases nowadays. In this case, we were asked to build a new building. This is a thing. But we wanted to reflect somehow this idea of a factory of art. So the whole building is made of one single material. In this case, it's concrete. And this concrete is not white. In this case, it's darker concrete, gray, normal concrete, because inside you don't need so much natural light. Actually, this will be eventually transformed by the way the artists use it. This system of polygonal rooms are connected one to the other in different ways. So with these doors that you see coming from above, you can separate one room from the other. You can have nine rooms together or three rooms together, etc., in different ways. They connect like a labyrinth. You know? If you see the photos, you see that they have a lot of different holes. Every 90 centimeters, you have a hole because there's double walls, and in between, you can connect light, sound, bars to bring beamers or projections or whatever. You see that every room has a skylight. This skylight can be made dark, of course, easily, electronically, but it has quite different scales. Sometimes the space is very compressed, as you see. Sometimes the space is very high. So again, when you look to the plan is always the same. but the section is always different in different situations. The doors connect different spaces in different ways. Some spaces are quite bigger, in particularly the last big hexagon, which is a black box that we said before, and that opens to the interior, which is a very big interior, like all the building basically conceived as a container, a space full of connections, as you see in the perforations, that can be used in different ways. And we are really waiting to see how it really becomes a usable space. There is only one big window, the big window that opens to the river, that you see from the outside this other way, whereas the smaller openings are for the studios of the artist. The studio for the artist, because most of the work is going to be digital art with computers and with printings and so on, are conceived as a series of rooms that can be extended or in different ways. The only material that you see here besides the concrete is this steel, this, I don't know, this sort of gray black steel, very industrial in the way it's perceived. The studios on the left are in relation to the exhibition spaces in some of the points that you see there, and in some places where you have the administration, the rooms, the natural light comes in different ways. You know that, again, we are in Cordoba, the sun is very strong. Sometimes in the day it's like that, sometimes the strong light through the perforations is coming to the interior. The roofs, something we mention in most of our projects, become again an important issue. They break the scale of this relatively big building. Of course, when the building by Rem Koolhaas was going to be built, the idea is that from above you could see the roof. Now the building is not going to be built, so you have to go to an airplane or to a helicopter or something like that. But then you see, but that's also important. Even if you don't see it, everything belongs to what architecture has to be, and therefore the roofs. So if you look at the roof, you see that the intermediate spaces there within the system are the patios. So the system of polygonal rooms is regular. The patios are leftovers, the spaces in between. But the patios become this space where in this sort of rather dark interior space, you suddenly see the light and you see the sky, which is basically what an introverted building like this, because it's conceived like that, does. And the only sort of extroverted part of the building will be this facade. This is a facade developed with this German group that I mentioned, in which we develop a system of prefabricated white concrete. The whole idea behind is that we didn't want to have a media facade. This is not a football stadium or a commercial center. It is an artistic facade where the artist can transform what they and do what they want, or even reject it, because this is what an artist does. Maybe we put that and then they hate it. That would be fine, okay. But we wanted to have something that where you don't see any glass, you don't see the light, you see only a white concrete facade that has to do with the geometry of the building. What you see here is this system of bowls. Each of these bowls, and we have 1,500 bowls, has actually a relation with the roof. It's simply, if you scale down the roof, basically you create the bowls. And these bowls actually are like pixels. Each of them is one of these 1,500 pixels with a lateral LED lamp, only white lamp. You see one of the tests we were doing there. These lamps have three different scales, because some of them are smaller, some of them intermediate, some of them are bigger, so that the perception of the building will be different. And eventually, when the light is coming from behind, they make the building appear much sort of lighter than what it is. So even if the building is not yet inaugurated, opened, the different tests have been done already with the facade. The facade is not yet in permanent use, but even, for example, the small test videos express the different possibilities that they will have. It's not only to project videos, it's also in real time, in streaming, like I think we are today here in the lecture. Artists from different parts of the world can immediately transmit something to what is going on there. On the right side of the image, in red, you see the mosque, like a permanent reference. That is on the other part of the river, so that the building, when you see it during the day, is simply a white prefabricated concrete element, and in the night somehow mysteriously becomes something that creates and works in different ways. The building hopefully will be in use soon. Thank you.